Today is November the 8th, 1994. The survivor is Hart Sigi. The interviewer is Deborah Cattler. The city is Los Angeles, and the language is English.
You can go.
My name is Sigi Hart. I was born in Berlin 1925, November 1925, and stop.
It's fine. You're doing fine.
Yeah.
It's okay. Yeah,
okay. I was born in Berlin and grew up there until my school time when I went to school first grade. And
tell me a little bit about your family. Tell me about your parents and your brother and your sister.
My parents, my mother Adela Hartmeier, we were Hartmeier in Berlin. Actually, first we were Begleiter, and later on, the German government decreed the law. My parents are from Poland, they're not Germans, that they have to come to present themselves, and they had to show papers. And the German government did not recognize the marriage by Rabbanut, from the rabbi. So my father had to take the name of his mother. So we were Begleiter until about 1935, and then we became Hartmeier. So I started school with Begleiter in 1931. And went to first grade and second grade as Begleiter. I have a sister her name is Manja, and I have a younger brother whose name is, we call him Willy Wolf. And we had a happy life, and as children, my parents were good to us. We had a good life. My mother was a housewife. My dad was a traveling salesman, and was a good provider. I cannot complain as a child. We had a pretty good life. And it started in 1933. Hitler came to power and started first with the communists, started trouble. Then started with the Jews, and I felt already in school, when I went to school, they put me in the last row of the class because I was Jewish.
How old were you when you first noticed that you were treated differently?
I was seven years old. This was my second grade going to school. It started. I looked fairly dark. I don't look like a real German, blue eyes and blonde. I was beaten up in school by the youngsters, and I was afraid to go to school. So my father decided. My mother was born in Auschwitz. This became Auschwitz later, in the infamous place. To go to Auschwitz to visit her grandmother. A lot of family lived in Auschwitz. So our family went to Auschwitz. We stayed there about a year, and we picked up a little bit of the Polish language. I started a school, kind of, in a village. And it was pretty nice. We had a lot of family there, cousins and uncles. And we stayed there till 1934. And my dad decided that it calmed down in Berlin, we should come back. We did not believe that really it will grow to something big, this Hitler. So we came back to Berlin. And my parents put me in a Jewish boys' school was called Kaiserstraße. And we lived pretty much in the center of Berlin, in a Jewish neighborhood. And I went there to school. It was a boys' school for, and we were about 800 boys in this school. Later, my brother went to the same school. And we still continued fairly quietly. I mean, we were taught not to make any noise in the street, not to be seen, not to be recognized as Jews. What do you mean recognized? We were children. We were playing. We were shouting. We were doing things, and our parents always said, "Psh, don't do it. Don't be remarked by the goyim. You know, they will beat you up." And it was really like this. When we went to school, we went three, four children from my home to the school. Was about 40 minutes walk. We walked to school. We left the house at 7. We were at 7:45 in school, from 8 till 2 o'clock. After school, we could not play in the street because Jews were beaten up. We went to a big synagogue next to our house, what was called the Oranienburger Temple. There was a class like where we can come after school to make our homework, to play chess, to play ping pong, to do a little sport in the back of the temple, just not to be in the street. Everything to be fading out from the streets, not to be seen. And it got worse every time we couldn't go to parks. They started writing on the benches in 1935. They wrote on the benches, "Nicht für Juden," means not for Jews. We could not sit on the benches in the street. We were not allowed to go to parks. We had a special place where we could go, and this was a little park about an hour out from Berlin. And this where the Jewish youngsters did some sport on the weekends. My dad worked as a salesman. He came home once a week. He left Monday and came back Friday. My mother took care of us. She was a good cook, good baker. She baked her own challahs and little breads for Friday night. She made the chicken soup. My father's brother, who lived also in Berlin, came over to Shabbos for lunch. And my brother and I, we went to shul Friday night and Saturday to sing in the choir. And we had a nice family life. And just that we have to be watching out for going in the street, because when you saw somebody, a few boys coming on the sidewalk, you went down. You didn't want to face them. You went down down from the sidewalk, and they passed. Sometimes they beat you. Sometimes they just shouted a dirty Jew at you, and you put your head away. And if they were trying to beat you, you run away. That's all you can do. And my uncle was pretty good. He was a violin player. He wanted me to learn to play the violin. He was also a pretty good a painter, painting pictures, landscapes. And I think in our family it's a little bit artistic, born in. My sister had a beautiful voice. She always was singing very nice. And my brother and I, we were always joking around. And in matter of fact, when my mother's brother got married in 1935, my uncle, who wrote a sketch for my brother and me to present at the wedding. And it was a pretty funny sketch because we spoke in Yiddish, what usually German boys don't speak Yiddish, but we learned it, and it was a very nice success. And it stayed with us. My brother also has a very, very nice voice. And I never went in deeper to singing, except of the choir and the temple, so we left it there. I started in 1937, I started to learn for my bar mitzvah. In Germany at that time, you needed at least a year to prepare for bar mitzvah because it is all in Hebrew and it takes time to learn the melody, the songs and the words and everything. And I started to learn. And, well, to come back to 1936, when the Olympic Games were played in Germany, all of a sudden from all the benches, from all the parks, the sign disappeared because there was a lot of people from all over the world coming to Berlin. So they overpainted the benches where it was written, nicht für Juden oder Juden unerwünscht, what means Jews are not allowed here. It was all of a sudden, it was all painted over like nothing ever happened there. And they had on a lot of corners those Stürmer papers, newspaper, with grotesquely painted faces of Jews with big noses and big eyes, and just to distort, this was all taken away from the streets. Berlin became a very clean, proper, nicely city for a few months in 1936, where we really enjoyed it.
What did you think about the contrast at that time? I mean, you were young, you were about 10 years old at that time, 11 years old?
Well, I was, 1936, I was 12 years old, 11 years old. Well, we were happy that we can go again. We did not think that when after the Olympics that everything will come back as it was. But it came back after the Olympiada, the foreign people left, and everything was done again. Juden unerwünscht, and the park were not allowed for us to visit. And we went back to our temple on Oranienburger Straße to make our homework and do our playing inside. And 1938 in November, no, this was before November, the German government overnight went from home to home. They had addresses from Polish Jews and took together all the men from who were born in Poland and put him in a big police station, and a day later were deported to the Polish border. It is like today, I remember, we were getting ready for school. It was 6:30 in the morning, and my dad was home. And on the doorbell rang, and I ran to the door. We had a very long corridor. I ran to the door, and there were two policemen outside standing, and they asked me, "Is your dad home?" And I was a child. I didn't know what was going on. I said, "Yes." And they came in, and my mother came right away. She was behind me and says, "Yes, what happens?" So she says, "We came for your husband." So my mother, she said, "My husband is not home." So my father was, in the meantime, he heard all this from the bedroom. He covered up with the cover on the other side of the bed. And my mother said, "Oh, my husband is home. I mean, in Berlin, he's a traveling salesman. He's home, but not in our house. He is not in the house." I don't know. The policemen came in. They were standing in front of the bed. or they did not want to see, or they did not want to make anything out of it. They just turned around and said, Frau Hartmeier, when your husband comes home, tell him to come to the police station. And my mother said, of course I will do that. And when they left, first of all, my mother looked at me, you know, she could not blame me because I'm a child. But my father jumped out, got in some things, got dressed, and went in. Excuse me. Our neighbors were German Jews. And he went in there and stayed there for a few days. And the next day, the people were deported to the Polish border. And my father stayed behind. I'm sorry. Now, afterwards, a day or so, we are having my mother and my father, we were at the neighbors, and they were talking, what will happen, they will see me in the street, and then they will put me in prison. Maybe it's worthwhile, I should go to the police department and present myself. And they decided after 3 days, the people, most of the people were already sent to the border. My dad decided to go to the police station and present himself voluntarily. He went to the police, he packed a little suitcase, and my mother and my dad went to the police station, and we three children, we were home, we were crying. We knew that if my dad's leaving, we don't know when we're going to see him again. And a wonder, after an hour and a half, about later, my mom and my dad came back, both of them. They went to the police station, and the policeman said, the action is over, we took everything we took, you can stay. And my dad stayed. So this was in 1938, must have been October or September in 1938. In the meantime, we prepared for my bar mitzvah, what was supposed to be on my birthday is November 15th, and my bar mitzvah was calculated a couple days. We go according to the Torah, so it came out the 15th was not exactly on a Saturday, so the Saturday after the 15th would be my bar mitzvah. On November 9th, 1938, in the morning, all of a sudden, we went out to school and we saw smoke and fire and temples. We in Berlin, they started like a pogrom. They started to breaking the windows. There were a lot of Jewish stores. They broke the windows from the stores and they took out the merchandise. They brought big, big picket signs, don't buy from the Jews. They started burning the synagogues. And so we went back to the house. We did not go to school. We stayed home. And my parents sent out my brother, who looks really like a German. He has blonde hair and blue eyes. And he went out in the street to see what's going on. Came back and told us that mostly all the stores, what belongs to Jews, are broken, the windows and the merchandise was pulled out. People are walking in and out from the stores like it was their own. And the temples were burned and the Torah and everything. And here, a week later, this was November 9th, and a week later, I'm supposed to have my bar mitzvah. So the family, everybody knew, was invited to the temple to come. And so we didn't know what to do. It calmed down a couple of days later. And the week afterward, we notified our family that we will make the bar mitzvah. We cannot make it in the temple because the temple was burned down and broken. There was a little house in the back from the gabbai, the person who takes care of the temple. He says, you can do it in my house. Tell your family to come. And the rabbi, who was already prepared for my bar mitzvah, who knew that I will have it, was ready for it. We came Saturday morning to this place. We had about 3-4 people standing outside watching if they see any police or SS or Nazis coming to warn us so that we can escape from the behind in the backyard. So I did, to describe the temple, it was a room. In one corner were the burnt Torah scrolls. They were laying on the floor. I'm sorry. They were laying on the floor covered. I did my bracha, and I did what I have to do for my bar mitzvah. The rabbi was standing, crying, told me never to forget. This was supposed to be my happiest day. Anyway, the rabbi told me when he made the bracha, he said, remember, never forget. Never. Okay. This was my bar mitzvah, 1938. We went home, and my parents decided this is not a life to continue. So my father found out there are people going over the border. You know, we could not get a visa nowhere. My father had a family in America, New York, cousins. He wrote before 1937 or 6 already, he wrote to America, to his cousins, that it starts to be bad in Germany if they can send him some papers to come to America. And they really did. They sent papers. They said, sent affidavits, what they called. We had to wait. My parents, born in Poland, there was a quota where you cannot just get a visa and come to America. You had to wait for your quota, and this quota was at least 5 years. And this was 1936-7. We had the papers, but we cannot do anything with it. We had to wait. So they tried to get visas to China, to Burma. I mean, and then my uncle says, what are you going to go to China? What will you do there? You know, it was... They did not believe that it will come to a point where Jews will be killed in Germany. Excuse me. My parents decided to go to Belgium. Belgium were not giving visas to enter, but they said if you as a refugee, if you come to Belgium as a refugee, they will keep you, they will not send you back. My father found out there is people for money that take you over the border. He said he will go first. And they always had the idea that the Germans won't do nothing to women and children. They didn't do really, in the 38s, they didn't do nothing to women and children. The proof was they took all the men away to Poland, not the women and children. So my father found out about the person and went and was smuggled into Belgium. This was after my bar mitzvah. It took a little while. We got news from him in Belgium. He went to Antwerp. He said he got news to us. He could not write because he wasn't sure that they will not open the letters and see what's written. So through people, he sent us message that he arrived in Belgium. He will make us come too. In January 1939, we got message from my father from Antwerpen to take whatever we can carry, not too heavy. We had in Berlin a two-bedroom apartment, a nice two-bedroom apartment with a bath and what was considered very nice, furnished, and we had a very comfortable life. My mother bought us big boots. We didn't know why. You know, it's cold in the winter. We never had boots, and we always wanted boots. And when after the bar mitzvah, my mother bought us boots, we were very happy. We thought it's for the winter. She wouldn't tell us that we go to Belgium. She was afraid we would tell somebody, and then we will be arrested because we couldn't flee Germany. So we got the boots. And in January 1939, my mother packed a suitcase and some light bags for us kids, for my sister, for my brother and me. And we closed the apartment. Whatever was in there, we closed it, went to the train station, and went to the over Cologne to Aachen. Aachen is a city near the Belgian border where somebody is supposed to meet us. He described the route. You drive to Aachen, you take a little train what goes into a village I remember till today was called Rote Erde, what means red soil, Rote Erde. And there a smuggler will meet us and will take you over to Belgium. We came to Aachen and we get off the train. I was sitting with my mother. We were not even all sitting together because we did not want to appear as a family leaving Germany. So my mother said to my sister and my brother, you sit in the next wagon and in Aachen, you go out, you take the little train, you will see me and my mother and me, and you will follow. And she didn't realize Aachen was a big city and a lot of people came out. And we went to the train to Rote Erde and my sister and my brother missed it. So here my mother and I sit in the train, we're going to the border and my sister and my brother is not there. We're going over to this little house on the border. It's a restaurant and pension, like a little hotel on the border, still in Germany. When you go out from the house, you're in Belgium. But we had to wait for a smuggler to pick us up there. It was all paid off. It was all people who made money on this. My mother and I, we were in this hotel, and it was in the afternoon. We were there till in the evening, 8 o'clock. My sister and my brother didn't come. The smuggler came, and there was another few people. We were not just my mother and I. There were another three or four grown-ups going. So the smuggler came, and my mother explained what happened. He says, well, or you stay or you go with us. I don't know how she decided. She said she's going. So we started a journey at night, what was very, very, very tough. It was raining and snowing. It was in January And we were walking in the woods. We were crossing rail stations. And after 5-hour walk, it was almost 3 o'clock in the morning. The smuggler told us to stop and sit there. He's going into the next village and come back with a car.
Interview Deborah Cutler, Los Angeles, language English. Second day.
We were waiting for the smuggler. And I forgot to mention, and it was a few years back, 1933, I was 8 years old. My grandparents, my mother's father and mother, lived in Berlin too, and they were very religious. I mean, observant and religious. When he goes to the temple, you're not allowed to carry anything. So I was the grandchild, the oldest grandchild, the boy. So he took me to the synagogue to carry his tallit, you know, the shawl, the prayer shawl. And we came from this was a Friday night, we came from the synagogue. And while we were walking, it was dark. The street was not very, there was not very many people on it. But from far, we saw two SS men on each side of the sidewalk, walking with the black boots, with the black uniforms, and the swastika on the, with the whole uniform, two on each side of the sidewalk. So my grandfather, when he saw this, he took me on his hand and he walked down from the sidewalk in the street, not to bother them so they can pass. At this moment, from both sides, the four guys approached, came to my grandfather and pulled out nightsticks and started beating him up. He was severely beaten, and I started screaming and crying until some neighbors came out and called an ambulance, and he was taken to the hospital. So this was one episode I want to mention. This was in 1933. To continue on our trip to our exodus from Germany to Belgium, we walked, like I said, the whole night. We were waiting there for the smuggler to come back with the car. 3 o'clock, it is 4 o'clock, it is 5 o'clock, nobody showed up. It's raining very strong, and it is cold. We are soaked from top to bottom, soaked, cold, shivering. We were so cold that we all got together. We came all together to get warmed up a little bit. And it started to get light. And it must have been 8 in the morning, because in the winter it doesn't get so early light in Europe. And all of a sudden, yeah, in the meantime, a few cars went by. It was a highway. Few cars went by, nobody stopped. And all of a sudden, one car came and stopped and blinked the lights. We were in heaven. We jumped out from behind the woods and ran to the highway. And there was a 5-seater car. I mean, 5 people could go in. And we were 7 or 8 with me. I was a bar mitzvah boy. Anyway, we all squeezed in this car, and he drove us to Antwerp. The smuggler told us that he couldn't start the car. He had an engine problem. He had to borrow a car from a friend. Anyway, this is why it took so long. But we thought that we were ahead for, you know, that we paid him and he left us in the woods. But it wasn't like this. He picked us up, and we came 2 or 3 hours later, we arrived in Antwerp, a certain place where my father was already waiting with other people who were from the other families. And the first thing, of course, where's Manja and Willy? So my mother cried and told him what happened. So he says, "Don't worry, they will come too." As it happens, we found out later, my sister, they missed the train. There were too many people, and they were held back. The train left, and they were stranded on the I don't know what you call it, on the platform. Yeah, on the platform from the train station. So my sister said, "Let's wait for the next train, and I put you in a train to Belgium straight. You're a little boy. Maybe nobody will ask you nothing. You know, when the police comes in the train, they ask passport and visas to grown-ups. Children usually they don't ask." So this is what she did, and she put him in a train, and he arrived in a city in Antwerp. And he didn't have any papers. There were people asking him, "Where are you going?" He says, "Antwerpen." And then they notified the authorities, and they called into Antwerpen and to the Jewish committee. And my father found out that my brother was on the way to Antwerpen by himself. Now my sister is stuck in Germany, and we always got correspondence through the Jewish committee. There were always Jewish committee who were helping Jews, refugees, and things like this. I don't know till today how they got in touch. My sister got in touch with my parents, and they sent somebody to Germany. She was stuck on the German border. Sent somebody to smuggle her in. So the man came with a bicycle and another bicycle. Luckily, my sister knew how to ride a bicycle. So the smuggler came with a bicycle for her, and they started riding the bicycle in from Germany over to the border. And they got into a big field of maneuver where German army were just maneuvering. And they were caught by the German military police, and the smuggler was a Belgian. And he talked, he says, "We are Belgian, we took a little ride on the bike, and we must have crossed." And the German, this soldier was nice enough to say, "Well, Belgium, you have to go this way." So they drove both into Belgium, and she came to the first city, and they sent a ticket to come to Antwerpen, so we were reunited. I mean, this was like a thing from heaven. I don't know how this all combination worked, but we were all five again back together in Antwerpen. So my father started to look for a little apartment. We were in a hotel room, but we got from the Jewish committee, put us in the hotel until we can find an apartment. And my dad found an apartment, and we all moved in there. It was a store, an empty store, what could never be rented. So they painted the show windows white with paint, and the back was two rooms and a toilet, and we had an apartment. And we stayed there for a while, and my father, you know, you have to make a living, and he did not know Flemish, this is the language they talk in Antwerpen. So he went to the bourse, it's a bourse where they deal with diamonds, especially Belgium, Antwerpen is very well known for the diamond bourse. And what does a Yidel do? He bought cigarettes wholesale, and he sold them to the dealers, the retail. And he made a little living, brought in some money here, some money there, and dealt a little bit on the boss, and we were surviving. My sister started a job as a nanny. She was at this time, excuse me, 16 years old, as a babysitter in a Jewish family. They took her in, and she was guarding a little girl. And she was fed, and so it was easy on us to survive. Excuse me. My brother and I, we were young. We were always happy-go-lucky, we were always optimistic, as we had from our parents. We never saw half glass empty, we always saw it half full. Though we were refugees in Belgium, we survived, and we hoped that the war will be over soon and we will go back. As it turned out, it got worse, and we stayed in Belgium. Me, myself, as a young boy, I did not feel the real, I did not have the problem with survival. We were children, we were taken care of by our parents. My dad was worrying for us, my mother was cooking, so we did not have any worries. We were going, from the committee, there was a restaurant, a Jewish restaurant, who served meals for lunch, and we went there, we met children, also refugees. There were a lot of children from Austria and from Germany in Belgium as refugees. We went to the parks, what we never could do in Germany, and we played, and there were family who lent us roller skates so we can play. We found out there's a big temple. My brother and I, we joined again the choir, and we were singing there. And in January of 1940 was my brother's bar mitzvah in Belgium. So here we had a nice bar mitzvah for him, and we were singing in the choir, and he had a beautiful bar mitzvah. This was in Belgium. Like I said, we were happy children, we played, and then my father said, enough of the playing, you're going to grow up, you have to learn something. So he had a friend who was a tailor. The tailor was working for the refugees. He was a refugee himself. He was working out of his house. He had a little sewing machine, you know, not even electric. You pedal with your foot. And I came up there. My father presented me, says, teach my son something to do. Like they say in Yiddish, lozen nemen a noodle in the hand. Let him take a needle in the hand. So he started to teach me about sewing. First he gave me a needle, even without thread, and he says, here, see, you go like this. He gave me a finger, thimble. A thimble without the top, it was just a thimble. And he says, see, you go like this with a needle, and very, very slightly you touch the fabric. And then he gave me white thread on black fabric, and it shouldn't be seen on the other side. So I did it until I did it well. Then he gave me little jackets to put in the inside of the jackets to
lining.
The lining, to put in the lining with already with the black thread. I was good enough to do this. And slowly, I was miserable. All the children were playing out in the parks, and I was sitting here with a needle. I was 14 years old, sewing. I don't know for what was the purpose. The purpose was he gave me 5 francs at the end of the week, like it's pocket money. So I did this, and my father was selling cigarettes, my sister was a nanny, and my brother was home. My brother was always very sensitive, fragile, and he developed in Belgium, he got sick, he had something with the gland, and this was from undernourishment. We didn't have, we were eating, but we did not get the right food in the beginning. I was always sturdy, I was always a roughneck, they called me. And so he was more the guarded one by my mother. He was home, and we were all busy. We had later on a nicer little apartment where we had already room for us, and in the street with regular apartments. And my mother started fixing draperies on the windows, and they were talking about some carpets. We had some second-hand furniture in the house. we built up, and it was very comfortable. We had a very nice, comfortable home again in Belgium, and we thought this will last forever. But it didn't. In May 1940, the Germans started to occupy. The Germans were already in war with Poland and France and England, but Belgium, Holland, and Luxembourg were still free. And in 1940, May 10, 1940, the Germans started to occupy Belgium, Holland, and Luxembourg. It started on a Friday. Hitler's movement was always on Fridays, I think. Must be one of his lucky days or whatever. We woke up with bombardments. I mean, they bombarded Antwerp, Brussels, and all the major cities. We ran to the shelters. First, we didn't know what happened. Then on the radio, they came out, Germany, didn't declare war, they started to drive into Belgium and Holland. So here we are, German refugees in Belgium. What do you do? People did not know what to do. There was a lot of Jews, Belgian Jews too. And Hitler once said in his speeches in Germany, I remember this, I heard it, he says, one day I will come to Belgium and clean up. There was a Pelican Street. Pelican Street is the major street of the diamond industry, and it was mostly in Jewish hands at this time. And Hitler said, I will come to Belgium and clean up this Jewish nest over there. And here we hear the bombs flying in May of 1940. What do you do? Where do you run? We don't have anything again, you know. Again, we took a package. My mother took a suitcase, my father's suitcase. We took little packages. We closed the house. We went to the main railway station, and were lucky because it was pandemonium, you say? I mean, it was terrible. People from all sides running to the trains. People from Brussels came to Antwerp, people from Antwerp went to Brussels. We didn't know exactly where they are, but we knew Belgium is small and Germany was very strong. How long will it take them to occupy? So we went to the train and was lucky to get the train to Brussels. We came to Brussels because Antwerp-Brussels is a little train that goes every hour like a subway. But it was underneath, it was a surface. Brussels, we came to Brussels, and there was a long train, a real train standing there, and everybody ran. We didn't have tickets, nothing. We just ran to the train. Everybody ran to the train. We didn't know even where it's going. So we sat down in the train, and the train started moving. It went, and it stopped, it went because there was bombardment, it was deroute. I don't know till today how this train could leave Brussels after those bombardments that the Germans did in Belgium. But the train moved, and after a couple of days, we arrived on the border of France. And on the border of France, we saw French soldiers, British soldiers, and we children, we were in the windows, Vive la France, this is the first word we learned. Everybody was shouting, the people in Brussels talk French. We just started to learn Flemish. From German to Flemish is not so difficult. And children, we learned fast. We learned very fast languages. And so, Vive la France, Vive la France. We shout Vive la France. We were happy to go into France. We know there's a war going on. France is a big country. There's soldiers, there's British soldiers. We will be able to be saved. The train went into France, and we were going and going. Wherever we stopped, the people, the local people sent the train farther. We stopped on big stations. We had to be fed. There was no food in the train. So on the train stations, it was wartime, there was a Red Cross like not stores, but stands who served milk and bread to the children and coffee. And later they knew that refugee trains are coming. And on major stations, people were received. Like when the train came, it stopped. We could go out and take things. Not buying because we didn't have money, but to get food and milk and whatever people need. And a lot of time happened that a mother, I know from a case, a mother was with two children in the train, and the father went out to get the milk, and the train left, and the father was gone. And there was no, you could not run after the train. It was not a regular train. It was not a scheduled train who came to the next station, and you can say, I go out, I wait for the next train for my husband. So after being about 8 days in this train, we arrived to the end of our line. It's really the end of the line. The train stopped and there was no more rails. I mean, it was the end of the France. It is called, this village was called Luchon, Bannière de Luchon. It is a spa, a beautiful spa, a little village. And where the village ends, you have mountains, the Pyrenees, I mean rocks. This village alone is about 1,200 feet already, 1,200 meters above sea level. Going into this, we went through mountains. I mean, I never have seen mountains in my life. We were always flatland, you know. So we came into those mountains. We looked around. We felt so closed in. Until we came to this village, and this train had about 1,200 people. Of course, they were not all Jews. There were maybe 300-400 Jewish people on this train, and we were infiltrated in France. There were fifth column, they called them, German parachutists. They parachuted as priests down to France and mixed in with refugees. And I don't know what they could find out from refugees, but this is how they went into France as spies. And we came to this village. There were some Belgian officers. And right away, they went to the French authorities there, and they said, we are Belgian, but there are a lot of Jews here, refugees from other countries, and so. So they separated already. In France, the Christian people were taken care of from the government, and they took care of us too the first few weeks. They put us in hotels, and we were fed by the hotels. In the hotels, we were fed and taken care of. And after a little while, it was we arrived there May 10, May 18. It was almost in the end of May, and in June, the French army capitulated. It meant that France is occupied, will be occupied by Germany. Here we are in a little village in the end of the tracks, and we hear the Germans occupied France. Then it became part Vichy, part German occupation. So luckily we were in the Vichy part of France. We were in Luchon about 2 or 3 months, and there was no radio communications, but they gave out flyers, and in the littlest streets in the village came a man with a drum, and he went from street to street drumming and shouting out announcement, avis, avis. This means announcement. And then he came. The government of France, the authorities of Luchon requires that all the Jews have to come to this place and present themselves. Okay. So we had to go to the city hall. Everybody got a paper that we are Jews and we are refugees. And also we got some cards, tickets for bread, oil, sugar, and, you know, things to live on, because there was no food to buy in a grocery store. You had to have tickets for everything, for soap, for chocolate, for everything you had to have tickets. We were in this village. They cannot just take us and throw us out. So they gave us a paper that put in a big Jew, and they gave us some tickets to live, £2 of sugar a month, a bottle of oil a month, you know, really the bare necessity. And as children, we received 350 grams of bread a day. So we were in this village, and my parents were looking for an apartment because we could not stay in the hotel. And right away came a Jewish committee. It was, I don't know from where the Jewish committee always, they always popped out like a mushroom, and people brought money. They got money from America, they got from the joint. I don't know how it got to France during the war, but they came and they helped. They gave money. They said, try to find an apartment. We will try to help you to pay the rent, you know. And my parents found a little apartment with a French people who had an imprimerie, printing shop. He was printing. They had once a week a movie, so they printed a colored poster, what movie is playing, what the announcements will be, and things like this. And they rented us a little apartment. Very nice people. And the man who had imprimerie had a son who was married, had two children. He was working there with his father, but he lived about 6 kilometers out of this village, from the city, Luchon, in a village what was called Jusette de Luchon. This was a small village about 6 kilometers away from Luchon. And we got friendly with those people, and we lived in this apartment until one day the drummer comes and announces all the Jews have to present themselves the next day on the train station. They will be taken to a different place. So there was nowhere to run. I mean, all mountains around and a small village. So we took our stuff again, got ready, and went to the train station. And there was already trains like they put in for horses. This was not regular wagons. It was, they called it viehwaggons, where they put horses and cows in. So we were loaded into those wagons. The train took off, and it must have taken about 3 or 4 hours later. They told us, we take you to a camp, to a working camp for the men. You will be happy there. You will have beds with white sheets, and the government will care for you. Don't worry. You will be together with your family. And we have to take you there because we cannot sustain you in the village. We don't have enough for food for the people. So we ended up in a camp was called Agde.
Interviewer Deborah Cutler, Los Angeles, English. Okay.
You were telling me about Agde.
Yeah, we came to this camp Agde, and it turned out to be a rotten place. I mean, there were barracks, empty barracks. We came there with children, women, and families, you know, whole families. And once they put us in, there was a gate with, what do you call this, barbed wire. And empty barracks. There were some soldiers. They came, okay, you get ready, get some straw and make your beds to sleep for tonight. So the men and the boys, like me, I went out with the men to get, there was a whole mountain like of straw bundled, you know, from like on the fields. We took this, we took it in, they gave us like a sack. We filled on the sack with straw, and this was our mattress. And the white sheets were our shirts. I mean, they were just trying to tell us that we shouldn't revolt or something to get us into this camp. So once we were in there, we had to do the best we could. The women and children prepared the straw bags for the night, and when the straw mattress were finished, the authorities, this was a camp with there were soldiers already and police, gendarmerie, they came into the barracks, says, okay, all the men line up. They took out the men and they put them in another camp. I mean, in a different area of barracks, separated also by barbed wire, where women and men could not see each other. I was in the middle. I could stay with my mother or I could go with my dad. So I stayed with my mother. And for me, it was all an adventure. You know, we were kids there, we were in barracks, we were sleeping on straw. It was camping for me because we did not realize really the troubles we were in. Our parents knew. But, you know, children play. We had our neighbors were prisoners of war from, it was called Indochina. It was Vietnam today, I think, where the French were fighting. And there were thousands of Indochina prisoners next to those women and children. You know, you see this, you get frightened. But they were very gentle people, they were nice people, they were prisoners. They tried to help. They were behind barbed wire too, we were separated, of course, from us. But we kids, we were playing there, we were playing soldiers. There were military helmets from military equipment. We took belts, we took helmets, we threw rocks, and we played. It was a playground for us. Until one day they decided I'm too big to be with the women and the children. They took me over to my dad, where the men are. In the meantime, like I said, we were there. It was September about. We were in Agde. And September, October, my brother, who, like I said before, was very fragile, he was sick. He got sick again, and he had to be taken to the hospital. So there was a city near Agde called Béziers. It was about 20 kilometers from Agde camp. So they took my brother to this hospital, and my mother got permission to visit. I mean, this was not a concentration camp. We were considered families and people and not runaways or things. In the beginning, it was okay. So my mother could visit. And then later on, I got sick. I got high fever and terrible headaches. And they were afraid maybe I got a typhoid or something. They brought me into the hospital too. So here I was in the same hospital. My brother was on the second floor. I was on the third floor. My parents were in the camp. My father separate and my mother and sister separate. I don't know how they did it. They got the permission to visit us once on a Sunday. They got the permit. They could take the train to come to the hospital, and they had to be back by 7 o'clock in the evening. They came at noon. They visited my brother. They took him out from bed. He was feeling better. I mean, I was already also a week in the hospital. I was ready to be discharged in a couple of days or so. My parents came on a Sunday. They told us, get dressed. We had our clothing nearby. It was in a hospital. We were laying in a room with another 20 people. It was not a hospital where you lay by yourself in a room. You had 20 people. And to make the story short, they made us walk out from the hospital. We walked to the train station, and we went back to Luchon, to the village where we came from, not knowing where we are going, what will expect us there. You know, we just left for there. And my mother and father decided that me and my father should go one station before Luchon, so that we are not coming as a family together, because it's a small village. You see, there come maybe 5-6 people, 10 people on the train station, and we don't look like French peasants there. So, and it was more later on, it was much, much more obvious that I walked with my dad. It was about 5 kilometers, was a station before Luchon. So I went out with my father, and my mother and sister and brother continued with the train to the end. Now, my dad and I was walking on the highway. It was the Route Nationale in France, going into Luchon, and we were both walking, and we didn't look like peasants. My father with a suitcase, and I have a little bundle under my hand, and two gendarmes on bicycles passed us. Usually, you saw a gendarme, you were shivering already, because these, they were terrible. The gendarmerie in France was, I could say, as bad as the Germans. They helped a lot to make the misery bigger than it was. Anyway, we walked. My father said later, he said, they must have gotten blind. An angel must have been with us. They drove by. They didn't ask us for paper, because France was known. When you see somebody in the street, your authority, let me see your papers. Étranger means refugee, they take you. Doesn't matter. So we were lucky. We made it to the village. Where do we go? To the apartment where we lived before, to this printer. This printer saw us. He cried. He was so happy to see us. We explained him what happened, that we come from a camp. He said, don't worry, my son will take you in his house. It was 6 kilometers from there in the village. There was no Jews. There was just, there were maybe 400 peasants, I mean people, not family, 400 people. And he sent for his son. The son came, and the son said, don't worry, I take you to my... He did not, this man must not know what he went into, because the Germans made sure always to announce, if you keep Jews in your house, you will be shot, you know. Anyway, they took us into this village. It was one building with a big living room where there was a chimney, where we cooked in and we warmed ourselves in. And we lived together with his family. This was a man, his wife, and 2 children. They kept us in this build, in this house, and to make myself to help, I asked if there is peasant who need people to help him on the fields to work. I found a family who gave me work. We worked on the fields. It was the winter. It was January of 1941 when we came back to this place, Luchon, and we went to Josette de Luchon. It was January. There was not much field work to do, but there were cows to be milked, and the stables have to be cleaned out. Wood has to be sawn, because there was no gas. There was no the heating was done by chimney, and like I said, we were sitting in the winter, the evening. There was no radio. There was nothing. We were sitting in front of the chimney with this French family. We spoke already a little broken French. My sister and my brother and I. And we could manage to talk. We were sitting with our parents and with them warming and cooking and living together. There was three rooms total. We five were in one room. And after a while later on, this man, whose name was Clément, built a little kitchen in the back so that we can use it. We couldn't even go through the house to the kitchen. We have to go outside. And there was a chicken coop. He made from the chicken coop, he built us a kitchen. The people were very nice. And his boy was my age, and his daughter was the age of my sister. So we lived a peasant life there. I worked with the farmers. It became slowly spring, and people started working on the fields. I worked on the fields, sowing, you say, putting potatoes in, taking the cows out in the pasture, and we went up to the mountains in the woods to cut trees, prepare trees for the next winter. The trees, when they fell them, they have to dry. They cannot burn them the same year. So trees were felled, and I made myself available to all kind of work. And for this, they gave me potatoes, they gave us milk, they made butter, and it was very, very convenient for us, and we could survive. In the summer, when the fruit came out, his name is Janot, he showed me all the tricks of the trades, like to say how to ride horses. In the winter, he showed me how to ski, because when it was snowing, we couldn't use the highways, and to get food from one house to another, we were skiing from one house, like cross country. And I learned skiing when you're young. I felt like I'm in on vacation. But I worked hard, and I liked it. I always was strong. I ate good. I drank good. And maybe this helped me for the future. This is what helped me for the future to survive. But everything is not, everything doesn't turn out forever. It came, the mayor of this little village knew that we are a Jewish family living there. And he started to pressure the family where we lived, that he's afraid that if it comes out, that they find out that they're keeping a Jewish family in this village, that they will get in trouble. And as mayor, he wants to take care that his village will not be damaged. So what is there to do? It was 1941. We were the whole year almost there. And where do you go from here? I mean, you don't go to the authorities and say, we are Jews. We lived in the village. Take us. We are not ready to turn belly up. So the mayor said, well, I can give you a paper where you will be sent for résidence forcée. This means a forced resident. We send you to another village, and you stay there in this village and see what happens. There are more of your people there. So we didn't have much choice, because he says, if we don't do this, then he have to go to the authority in Luchon and tell them that there's a Jewish family living in this village. I mean, the French were good to a certain point. When it came to their own skin, some of them, they were nasty. He gave us a paper, and our family, we got ready. I mean, it was heartbreaking, because we grew together to this family, and they loved us, and we liked them. And we had to leave. There came the time we had to leave, and we left for another place called Aulus-le-Bain. It is not too far from there, but it is close to the border. It was also in the Pyrenees, and close to the border of Andorra, very close. So we went to the city, came up by bus, And there was already a Jewish community, there was a little committee there, and here we again, my father always said, when we are with a bunch of ours together, this is problems, because it is notified by others, and this will be a problem. Anyway, we got to this village, and we found a little apartment there, and I started working first. There was nothing to do. There was a, I don't know how you say it, you know, in the mountains you have a where you break stones for cement. It's like terraces. You work on the mountains, you work with a quarry. I worked in a quarry there. I was 15 years old. I worked in a quarry for a while, and it was very hard work, and I couldn't continue. And my father took me out, and I tried again on the fields, and we got friendly with the owners of the apartments who rented us. It was a small building. We got together some eggs, we put the chicken on it, and we got little chickies, and we got a little piece of land from the owner of our landlords, so to say, and I planted some maize and potatoes and radishes and started like a peasant, what I learned from the previous village, what I did, and it started to grow, and we were doing our living there, and until one night, in the middle of the night, some people came to the door, knocked on the door, and they shouted, "Hermann, Hermann," this was friends of my father, "Hermann, the Germans are coming." "Oh my God, the Germans are coming, what do you do?" He woke us all up, it was midnight, he woke us up, he says, "Get dressed, quick, get dressed." So we all got quick dressed. "What do? We have to go in the mountains, the Germans are coming." I knew the mountains because I was working around there, so I took him up, about half hour, 45 minutes up into the mountains, and we sat there the rest of the night with covers, and it was already cool, and we were sitting there the whole day, and the next day my father said to me, "Why don't you go see what's happening, if there's any Germans in the village?" So I slowly got down at the daytime. I was already dressed there like the peasants. I had my beret and with the cane, you know, I was more like a peasant. And came down, and there was nothing. The rest of the people were in the markets, were talking, nothing happened. It was a false alarm. So I quick went up and says, "There's nothing happens." So we all came back down to the apartment. We came back to the apartment, and the day passed, we went to bed. Midnight again, they tap on the door, "Hermann, this time they're going to come." And my dad, he didn't fool around. He got up, woke us up. My sister said, "No, I'm not going." And my mother said, "What do you saw? Nothing happened. This is nothing." He says, "No, we are going." So we didn't have a choice. Papa is Papa in the family. And we went again up the mountains, and we stayed. And the next morning, I came down, and I saw a peasant coming up the mountain. He says, "Oh, you're here." He says, "Hide. The German took all the Jews from the village." So then we started climbing. I mean, we went up 2 hours, 3 hours up in the mountains. Okay, we were up there for about 6 weeks. I went down nights and grabbed out with my hand the food from what we planted and made us survive. After 6 weeks, we were almost starving. A French patrol of gendarmes caught us, took us down to the village, and took us to the train and brought us to a camp what was called Vernet. Vernet, my parents, we were all together in Vernet, and it was terrible. Over there we saw already concentration of a lot of Jews. From Vernet they took us to Gurs. Gurs was a camp where they were deporting to Poland. I don't know till today, my my parents, and we were together. And we children, my brother and I, we were taken out from the camp to a farm, to a boy's farm. My sister to a girl's farm, and my father escaped from the camp. My mother was the only one left in Gurs. And we were at the boy's farm for 2 months and got note from my dad. He was, in the meantime, he went to Italy, to Nice, the south of France, because the Italian occupied this part of France, and it was known that the Italian did not let deport their subjects. So my father went to Nice and wrote us a letter to my brother and me, sent us some money for train money. We were near Bordeaux in this farm school, sent us money to get to Nice to be with the Italian. We went to Nice, and on the other hand, my sister came too. We were all four together in Nice, and we were put by the Italian authorities to Olus-les-Bains, to Saint-Martin-Visibu, what is a village near in the Alps near the Italian border. It was occupied by the Italians. We had to present ourselves every day twice, and we were a family about 400 there. In 1943, in August of 43, Badoglio capitulated to the American army in Italy, and Italy broke down, and the Italian army left Nice and left France for Italy, and they said to us, save yourself, you can go wherever you want from this village. We crossed the mountains, 800 Jews, women, men, and children. We crossed the mountain over to Italy. We were on the way for 3 days. And we came to the first Italian village, Valdieri called. The German were there already. We went down, and when we saw the command car, a German car in the middle of town, my brother, sister, and father, we went back to the mountains. We hid there, and the Germans took all they can take in this village who came. They knew already the Jews are coming from France. They took them in a camp out of the city, and we stayed in the mountains. It was time where you have the castanias. I don't know how you say it's a fruit of a tree that grows. We lived from this. We went to some peasants, some helped us, some didn't, until we got on our way. My sister decided to leave to see if she can get to Rome. She left us in the mountains. She went to the train, and this was it as far as I knew then. My father, my brother, and I, we took a train 2 weeks later. We never heard from her. We took the train later and got from there to Genova, where we went to a convent, and a priest helped us to, we tried to get close to the border where the fights are, where the Americans are liberating, gave us some money to go to Florence. We arrived in Florence. We went there to a couvent, to a convent, and they helped us to hide in an old movie theater, what was empty. It was an old, there was a stage, and the benches were taken out on the balcony, and they made room for another. We were 30 people in this movie house, hidden. Men, the women were taken in convents for women. And there was also a temple in Florence where I visited, and I met a family, an Italian family with a girl my age, but I fell in love, like, you know, I liked her very much. And we went, and we were friends, and we were in this movie house until one morning in November 4th, I think it was, at 5 o'clock in the morning. Raus, auf, raus, you know, the German voices broke in this movie house, broke the doors with rifle butts, moved in and turned over the beds, raus, raus, and there were lorries outside, or the trucks, and they put us on trucks. At the same moment, there was a little chaos, And my brother luckily went up the stairs where the balcony was, where there was all the chairs were stored, and he went under the chairs, and he was never seen. They did not see him, so he was safe. We were taken to the trucks with my friend Ludi Goldman, who was a good friend of us. He went with us to Ogden. We met back in Italy together in Saint-Martin-Vésubie, and we walked into Italy together. So he and his father and my father, who were friends from Germany still, we were all together caught, and they took us to Florence in a big caserne. A big caserne, military caserne, and put us in the stables where the horses used to be. And this was in the morning, and during the whole day, they brought in people. They prepared the transport. They brought people and people and people, and we went out to the bathroom during the day, and I saw near the bathroom there was about a 16-foot wall, but had hooks in it, in the wall. And I said to my friend, this is a place where maybe tonight we can try to escape. And he saw it too, and we decided to try it tonight. And I told my dad, and my dad says, I go with you. And I says, okay. We went all three to the toilet, and it was already starting to get dark. My friend Ludi, the first one, he went up one, two, three, and he was over. There was a big barbed wire on top. I don't know how he made it. He was over. He was gone. I said to my dad, no, you go. My father was older. He is older. He was 43 years old. He went up and went to the second notch, and he slipped. Underneath was a big metal cover for something, a hole or something, and it made a big boom, like a gong, you know. And I said, oh my God, now the Germans will come. And he went back in the toilet, it was quiet. He went up again, and I pushed him. He made it. He made it over the wall, and I went out to the toilet. There was a guard. I came out to the wall. I wanted to do it. There was already a German soldier. What are you doing here? In. And he pushed me back into the barracks, and they closed, and this was it. We could not get out from the barracks anymore. The next morning at 6 o'clock, we all had to get up, take our belongings, what we had. Everybody got four rolls, little rolls, and they put us in the trucks. It was maybe, I would say, about 800 to 1,100 people, Italian Jews. And we were just a group of 30 Jews escaped from France, but they took all Italian Jews also. And we came to the train station, and there I saw again this family, this Jewish family with this girl, and I stick to them together because my father was gone, nobody, my friend was gone, I was left alone. And so I hung onto this family to be with somebody, and we were loaded into the train. And wagons, it was for animals. So we were, it says, 9 horses or 40 soldiers. And they put us in, we were maybe 60. And I was with this family. And they closed the door, and on the train, on the wagon of the train was written Auschwitz. I did not know what is Auschwitz. And some people, Auschwitz, I heard about it, we heard about it. But they loaded us in, they closed the wagons, and we were 9 days on the way, the 8th, we were sent away November 5th, we were deported, and I arrived in Auschwitz November 13th. We were going, we were in the train, and at this moment, when I was in the train, I realized I was no more child. It became to me like you take away a curtain, that this is the real thing, that here something is going to happen. We were in the train. We came after 8 days. We arrived in Birkenau. Of course, we didn't know at this time it was Birkenau. We arrived, they opened the doors from the train. I saw a round gate and a platform with, it looks to me like monkeys, a lot of inmates with striped pajamas and the Germans with their black boots and pants. Raus, 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 and schnell. And right away they separated women from men and pushed in a corner. And here were all the men standing, and SS men with a whip, with a horse whip, came and touched the men on the shoulder, and immediately there was a inmate, pulled him away to another corner. So he went about 12 times, 12 people were pulled out from this transport, 12 men, and I was standing the last one. My dad, when he jumped, he left the coat. I had a long coat on with a shawl over my face. And the SS man asked me, "What is this? Is this a girl or a boy?" I says, "I'm ein Junge," means I'm a man, not a female. So he touched me with a whip and put me, and I was the 13, and the father of my friend Ludi Goldman. 14 people were chosen in one corner. And the rest were pushed together with the right away with the men and women, put back on trucks and taken away. We were standing there while assessment came. He said to us, "Do you feel good? Does anybody feel sick or something?" My friend's father said he doesn't feel too good. He had the surgery. He says, "Okay, you go with the women and men." They went straight to the gas, what we found out. Straight from there, they went into the gas chambers. We were left 13 men. We were chosen to go into the camp for work. So we came in. We came into a barrack. We had to undress completely, wear shoven hair, underarm, wherever there's. We were shoven, and those people who did the haircuts to us told us right away, you see, we saw the chimney, we saw through the window big chimneys with big buildings, with chimneys, and there was a lot of smoke coming out. And they says, "You see, this is where your people are coming out now." We thought it was a joke, you know. I said, "What do you mean? They went to the other barracks." "No, they went to the gas chambers." You know, at this moment, everybody realized we were in Auschwitz, in the death camp. So when we were shoven, we were put in from one barrack to the other to go to a shower. We went to the shower. We came out on the. We left our clothes, our shoes and pants. Everything was left. We got into the next barrack and we came out prisoners in stripes. We were put into a quarantine for 4 weeks, where we worked inside the camp. Then we did. After this, we were put in a. In this was Birkenau. We were put in the main D camp, where they did all the labor. We were working there through the winter, but it was very, very, very hard. And in April, they were looking for transport to the Warsaw ghetto to clean up. They put together two transports. I was one of the transport to go. One transport was sent to Warsaw. The other one was not sent, it was sent to Buna. Buna was a factory, a chemical IG Farben factory, where they used to make, where they made rubber and tires, all chemical things for the war effort. In Buna I worked for until January of 1945, when we heard already the Russian cannons in the background, and the Germans prepared the camp to evacuate. We were evacuated. We walked 3 days through Gleiwitz. In Gleiwitz were already street fighting by the Russians when they still had time to put us on wagons, and we were transported to Nordhausen. Nordhausen was a factory for V2 rockets, what they sent over to London. We were this factory was underground. It was in a mountain, carved out from the rocks. I was working there, until the end of March 1945, when we heard already cannons again in the background that was fighting around the city of Nordhausen. We were next to Nordhausen, and the Germans had again time to evacuate us, put us on flat wagons, on trains, and we were again a few days on the road, and we ended up in Bergen Belsen. Bergen Belsen, we did not work, we did not eat, we didn't do nothing. We did just starve. We were eating leaves, we were eating whatever came in the people were, it's known that people were eating pieces of other people. The hunger was this big. One day, one morning, we heard a very, very funny noise, like a million of chains rattling. And it came closer and closer, and the soldiers were gone. All of a sudden, there was no more guards. And here, a British unit. British Army liberated us. This was on April 15, 1945. We were free. We were dead free. We didn't know where to turn. No family, nobody. And after a few days, different commissions came from different countries. We had from all over the world, people from Greece, from France, from England, from Germany, Poland, all inmates. And of course, the people from France and Belgium took their people right away. They didn't want them to linger around in the camp there in Bergen-Belsen. So I talked pretty well French. Papers we didn't have, I just had the number. And I went to the French commission and said, I am French, born on the border from Elsass-Lothringen, and my name, I gave my real name, and I said, I'm a French citizen, I would like to go back home. So they considered me as a Frenchman, and I got a paper showing that I'm French, and 2 days later, my name was called out, and all the French people were sent on trucks to France.
Sigi, before you go on, can I ask you some more questions about your camp experiences? Were you ever able to do anything while you were at the camps to get more food or to get any special circumstances? Or how did you survive those experiences?
The food we got was, we got in the morning a portion of bread, a little piece like this, and so-called tea or coffee, something black to drink. And at night when we came back, we got a soup. And when we were at work, we got, they brought out some soup too. Of course, it was not enough. It was just one spoon of soup, and what we got. And I made some friends in the camp who were also from Berlin. And you know, one tries to help the other one, and they let me wash their what do you call it, where you put the food in, like thermos, big thermos. I could wash them, and there's always some food left, so I could gather some extra food and have extra for me, and I helped some friends of mine by giving what I have too much. And I survived by washing some socks and pants for the kapos. The kapos was dressed better, they were dressed better, they got more food. So Sundays when we were in camp, we had to do camp work, so I was washing laundry for my capo, and I got some extra bread for it. So,
was this at Nordhausen?
No, this was in Buna.
Oh, Buna.
In Birkenau, I was living straightly from the ration what we got. It was very meager. The Germans were very surprised that we could survive. They figured out that we can survive maximum 3 months with the food they're giving us. but we survived longer. And we were working outside. Sometimes you found something. There were British British soldiers were also in these factories working, and they brought sometimes extra soup and they put it in the corner so we can take it, because we were not allowed to have any contact with any other people than with our own.
Were you with anyone that you knew while you were at these three camps?
The only one I knew was one man in my age, one boy my age, who came together with me. And I know only that from the 13 people, there's I am left, and the last one I knew was the boy who was with me. I lost contact in January 19 in Buna, but as far as I know, I'm the only survivor. If this man lives, then we are two.
Were there any famous people that you were with when you were in these camps?
There was a French Olympian swimmer, French Moroccan. At this time, it was like being French. His name was Nakash. He was in the camp, and there was a young boy, maybe a year or so older than I, who was from Greece. His name was Salomon. He was boxing in Buna for getting a little bit more bread. I know him very well. He is in Israel now. I know there came a movie out from him, but I never saw him back since since I was liberated.
Was there any time that you had to do something in the camps that you don't talk about, or circumstances that made you do something that you wouldn't have normally done in those circumstances?
Well, we had to pick up dead bodies from bombardments. I mean, that's not a usually work, but it was very common in the camp. When somebody died, people died on the march in, to make it harder for us to, after 12 or 14 hours work at the camp, at the work site, so to march in, we had to take two bricks and walk in, whole commandos with bricks, because the Germans wanted to build a new building, so they didn't want to spend the gasoline for the trucks. So they made the inmates, we were 10,000 of them. You imagine, if 10,000 people bring every day two or three bricks in, so they saved the transportation. This was a hard, hard thing, because we walked about 40 minutes, half an hour in the snow with wooden shoes in the winter, or it was icy, you were sliding, or in the fall it was melting. It was like going in mud ankle deep. It was very hard. They tried to make it as hard as possible for us, and instead of bringing, let's say, if they have to transport dirt, instead of taking it in little lorries, we had to carry it in boxes with handles on, two people, and doing it while running. So they tried everything. I like I said in the beginning, I was very strong. I worked all my life, and I was kind of conditioned. I was a big optimist. I always said, I'm going to come out from where my mother is born. I'm not going to die. And God helped.
When you look back over that period, is there any special incident or event that comes to mind that you want to talk about now before we go on?
There's so many incidents that I don't feel that there's any special. Everything is, unfortunately, is special for other people who didn't go through it. But it became a way of life and death. We tried to survive, and people do a lot of things to survive, even steal some other bread, what was like a death sentence. You know, But and then if you go to work and you didn't walk fast enough, you came home, you got 25 or on your behind, you know. I got once 5 because I wanted to make some more soup in the evening. And, you know, we were 900 or 800 people in one barrack. So there was, for the toilet to go, you cannot go at night to the toilet. There was a big barrel. And the men were peeing in there. And when it got full, somebody has to take it out at night or whenever. So everybody who had to go at night to the toilet, you know, was watching the barrel. If it is 3/4, they were rather making the mattress than to go at night in the winter to carry out. Two men were carrying about 100 liter. I mean, it's very heavy to get out in the night in the snow or whatever and take it to the toilet and empty it. So I was a night guard there, and it was up to me. When I saw the barrel is full, when somebody came to urinate, I had to keep him sitting there till the second one came, to keep him too, and then to put him out to empty it. Once I fell asleep, and my block, the man who was responsible for the barrack, caught me. I was just dozing. And I right away got hit by him. He woke me up with two big, in French you say gifle, backpfeifen in German. He hit you in the face. So I woke up and he says, I want you in the morning to the appel. And I got 5 over my behind because I fell asleep during my duty. And another thing I remember very, very vividly, the first day I came to the camp, and we were tattooed, and I went to the barrack, and there was mostly Polish people, and they called the numbers for food, they called in Polish. I did not know Polish. When my number was called and I didn't answer, they had an extra portion of food. They were very glad that I didn't answer. But I made sure the next day that I know my number in Polish. And I can still remember, this is my number. But I had to remember, there was no name calling. You were just a number. So of course, when we were liberated, I didn't believe it. We had to go touch the soldiers. But it was true. And we were sent to France first by truck. Then they took us in an airplane, in military airplanes. It was, I remember till today, the Dakota tree, where the parachutist went out. They had an airfield in Reims, not far from Belgium, I think. They took us in the airplanes, they took us to Belgium, Brussels, marched us to the main street in our uniforms. I changed my uniform in Bergen Belsen. I found a dead German. I took his jacket, and this was warm. It was in April, so it was still cold. And I arrived in Til Paris with a German uniform jacket. And in Paris, the Jewish committee took care of me, and I wanted just to retrace my route from when we went over to Italy. Maybe I find my parents. My mother was left in France when we left for Italy. She was in the camp. She couldn't get out from the camp. She was left for dead. She had a typhoid fever. She was left in the camp. The Germans said she will die. We don't have to transport her. She was saved by French people. I found it out later. So when I came to France, I wanted to trace back. We were going from France to Nice to Saint-Martin. I wanted to, even was ready to walk my way back to Italy to trace. And coming into to Nice, to the train station, was a Jewish committee who welcomed. We got passes to ride on trains and buses and free, as deporté politique, they called us. Not the Jewish deportees, politique, deporté politique. So I had this pass, we had a special reserved wagon to travel. I went to Nice, and in Nice, when I went out from the train, there was a Jewish committee, and there was a girl I knew from Nice at the time I was there. She saw me, and I saw her. We embraced, and she said, "Sigi, from where are you coming?" They all thought I'm dead. And she told me at this instant, at the train, my mother's alive in Toulouse, what was a few hours train away. And my father was saved in Italy. My brother, at this time, was in Palestine, was also saved. And my sister was in America. So the first thing they did, telegraph my mother that I'm alive and on the way to see her. So a few days later, I arrived in Toulouse, where she was, and, excuse me, the thing is, arriving in Toulouse is fine, but what they did, they, in Toulouse, instead of a taxi, they had a Red Cross wagon parked for me. I arrived at 5 in the morning, and they kept me. I didn't want to wake my mother. I knew 5 o'clock in the morning to arrive. So there was this Red Cross wagon from the military. They thought they'd get in here a body, you know. They were waiting at the train station in Toulouse for me. My mother didn't know when I'm going to arrive, but I had the address already. So I came to Toulouse. They take me, put me in the Red Cross wagon. I was sitting there, and they drove me to the house where my mother was living with people who saved her. And when the car drove onto the house, my mother came. She was on the second floor looking out from the window. We were both looking at each other, you know. We couldn't talk, of course. And then I ran up, and we embraced. And then I found out exactly. She did not know I was deported. My father wrote her letters to the Red Cross. And he always wrote about my brother Willy and Manya, how nice everything is. She said, "What's with Sigi? Why don't you write from there?" "Oh, Ziggy's fine. He's working with the peasants." She says, "Yeah, I want to have a picture from all four of you, my mother." So my father didn't know what to do. He took an old picture and he sent it to her. And my mother recognized it, that it was not a picture from before. She knew that was a picture from before she had it. And as it happened, she only knew from my deportation a few months before I came back that she found out that I was deported, and nobody knew where I was until 1945, where I gave also my name to the Red Cross and announced that I'm alive and back from Auschwitz if anybody is looking for me. That I'm in liberated from Bergen Belsen. And of course, the most thing I wanted to escape from Germany, I was so afraid that maybe they will return, they will get strong again and beat the Americans and catch Jews again. I was so afraid. I was walking in the street and turning around. I didn't believe that I was free to walk in the street where I wanted. I was asking my mother if I could eat. I was hiding bread under my pillow still in France for a while. You know, it took me a little time till I got used to normal life. I was sent from the French government. This is what they did. They sent me for 4 weeks on a rehabilitation place to gain weight, to gain strength, and to become normal, I mean to live a normal life. They sent me to a place called Lourdes. Lourdes is a very famous place in France from they have a saint girl who I don't know their religion, there's about a saint in Lourdes, and it's a beautiful place in the mountains near the Pyrenees. And that's why I went for 4 weeks. I recuperated, I gained weight, and came back to my mother, and I told her that I'm not going to stay in Europe. I want to go to Palestine at this time. It was Palestine. She said it's very hard to go to Palestine because you have to get it's called a certificate. The British gave a certificate only to certain people. They didn't give. I said to my mom, I'm going to Paris. I'm going to the English consul. I was liberated by them. The least they can do is to unite me with my family. I will tell them that all my family is in Palestine, so they have to send me. And that's what I did. In July of 1945, I arrived in Haifa on a British warship called the Matador. I mean, it's not a warship, it's a transport, military transport ship, brought me from Marseille to Haifa in 1945, where I was the first transport. We were about 200 deported people back from the camps who went to Palestine. We went the first one to arrive in Haifa. In Haifa, we were put in a camp again called Atlit. Atlit, here we're coming to a free, we're free, and they put us behind barbed wire again. Of course, we started to revolt and scream and not eating. And the British were guarding it. It was under a British mandate at this time. So they said, well, you're here in the quarantine. You don't have to be afraid. You're free people. Just that we make sure you don't go out. Maybe you bring a sickness from someplace, you know. So we want you to make sure that you're all healthy, then you can go wherever you want. It was true. We were there for two, three weeks. My brother, of course, knew that I was there. He came to pick me up. And from there we went to Tel Aviv, and I lived with my grandmother. My grandmother was living in Tel Aviv. She took us in, my brother and me, and my mother was still in France. And when I was on the transport to Palestine, my father was still in Italy, and when he heard that I go to Palestine, he took a taxi from Rome with a friend, father whose son was with me on the boat. He came to Napoli by taxi to take us off the boat. He did not want us to go to Palestine. So they missed the boat. Like you say, they missed the boat. They saw the smoke, the boat leaving Napoli when they arrived there. So it was too late. We went to Palestine, and my father decided that they'll come too. They joined us, and my father joined in 1945 later on, and my mother too joined. She came, believe it or not, she came with a children transport. She was smuggled with the children transport to Haifa from France. So she arrived. So my mother, my father, my brother and I, we were together, all together in Israel, in Palestine, and my sister was in America. So she went to America because she thought that everybody was killed. She knew only we were deported. She didn't know that my brother and father escaped, and my mother was taken for dead anyway a long time ago. So Roosevelt invited a boat of 900 refugees, a gesture in 1944, and my sister was on this boat. Was taken to Fort Interior, was also a camp where they were supposed just to stay there over the war and then send back after the war. But things changed. I lived in Israel. I was already a little bit more freer. I joined the Haganah in Israel. And it was the thing to do. We were young, we were a group, and we said we were going to fight. We never will let us nobody is going to take us alive again, like we went like sheep to the to our death, you know, to the camps. Whenever somebody wants something, they will have to fight for us. And since then, I have a kind of love for army, for the Israeli army. I have guns here in my house. I mean, I became a gun lover for just the sake of guns, target shooting and things. I was an excellent shot in the army. And lived in Israel until 1947. It started with declaring they wanted a Medina to Israel. And of course, it became in 1948.
Yeah. Because it was just cut off.
Okay. Or you want to say something?
No. Are you going to slide it?
Yeah.
Okay.
November 8, 94, survivor has Sigi, interviewer Deborah Cutler, Los Angeles, English. Fifth day.
1948, Israel was declared as Medinat Israel, and of course, right away, the war started with all the Arab country, and it was no doubt about that we are joining, and we became the army. And I fought in the Galil and was liberated from the army in 1950. I was liberated from the army and went, of course, every month we had, every year we had to go 1 month. And then had a nice life. I worked in different jobs. I didn't have really a trade. Worked in different jobs. And Hanukkah of 1952, we made a bachelor Hanukkah party, and a friend of mine brought a girl, a French tourist, to this party. And it, I was the cook. I was cooking latkes. Everybody was dancing, and she peeked on in the kitchen, and I met her. I saw her. I fell in love right the first time I saw her, and she became my wife. Her name is Vera now. She is a born Vera Vogel, but we got married in August of 53, and 55 we had our son born. His name was Shlomi, and it was hard. It was hard work for me in Israel. I lost a few jobs because I went once a year to the army, and there was no law that I'm allowed to continue on my job. So whoever got my job, I had to look for something else. Until 1956, I worked on a taxi cab. I was stopped in the street in 1956 to pick up soldiers from the house, because they started in the Sinai War 1956 in November. I think it was November, October. It was a six-day wars. This was my last fighting in Israel, and I said, I had already a little boy, and I didn't want to die in the desert. I want to continue living. I wrote to my sister. She sent me papers from America, and we left Israel in 1957. In February of 57, we left Israel, arrived in New York March 1st. March 1st, we arrived penniless to New York. I don't know why we just had $10 we could take out from Israel, but I had family who's the people who sent us papers in 1936 to Germany made a get together and invited us, and they bought a ticket for us to continue to Los Angeles. We took a plane. My sister lives in Los Angeles since 1944. The plane was taking us from New York to Los Angeles. It was a 12-hour flight then by propeller, and I started to look around here for jobs. I didn't know how to get around. I didn't have a car. In Los Angeles, you have to drive. My wife had a lady taken care by her name, de Rothschild, Baroness de Rothschild. My wife was in an orphanage in France, and this lady happened to be in America at this time, and she knew us. She invited us to her house, and she asked me if I have a job, and I told her about the situation. She told me to come back a week later, and she had a car for me ready. She actually presented me with a car so I can go to work and travel around. This was my first big break. And I worked around until I had a friend coming here from Israel also. He was in the drapery business. He taught me a few tricks of the trade, how to install drapes, and I became very good in it. And I became a drapery installer until someday I was hanging drapes. An acquaintance of mine asked me if I can get together $10,000 looking for a partner. At this time, we were already living in a duplex, but we were paying slowly. And my wife said, yes, we will do it. You know, I asked her, can we afford it? Can we do it? She was always, go for it. We remortgaged our house. It was not enough. We borrowed from friends' money. And in the meantime, we had a second baby here, our daughter Carmela. She was born in 1959 in February. And in 1967, I went into the manufacturing business as a partner, and we did boys and men's sport shirts knit, and the company was called California Knitwear, and it was pretty successful for quite a while, and till later on we had to switch over to contracting, and I got sick, so I had to retire from the manufacturing. My partner in the meantime died. I'm still partner with his wife. We have the property downtown, and this is from what we make our living, from the rental of this building. So this is more or less my story. I have a wonderful family, and I'm happy to be alive.
Well, I know that we'll get a chance to meet some of your family. I have some questions. It sounds like there were many heroes that helped you and your family survive. And I was just wondering if you knew the names of the French family that helped you.
Yeah, the French people who kept us almost a year in their house, they are dead. The parents, the children, who is now the man Janot and his sister Jeannette. I went back in 1982 to make a visit, and this was after 40 years. They couldn't believe it. They thought we are dead. We met. It was a very, very emotional reunion, and he called me my brother. And I visited with him 3 months ago this year. Gazave. His name is Janot Gazave. His sister lives still in Luchon, and he lives near Toulouse in a village called Gazère.
And you also mentioned the priest in Florence.
Do you remember the name
of the priest?
No. My brother actually was taken care by a priest in a orphanage. He was with my friend Louis Goldman, who wrote also a book about our story. Was hidden in an Italian orphanage.
Do you know the name of that priest?
Giovanni. Giovanni. I remember the name Giovanni. He came even once to Israel to visit with my brother and Louis Goldman. This Giovanni passed away already. But it was a lot of the Italian people who helped mostly survive the Jews, and the French, who were the Allied forces, did everything possible to give out the Jews to the Germans. I mean, they did work what they were not necessary to do. They did. To get rid of the Jews. That's all I can say.
Okay, I know that your wife is here. I'd like you to introduce her.
Okay.
A strong voice.
Okay.
I would like to introduce my wife, Vera, for the last 41 years. my best friend and companion.
Vera, you are also a survivor?
Yes. I grew up in France. I was born and raised there. And
you were in an orphanage?
After the war.
It's okay.
Sigi, did Vera have a large family?
Actually, my parents came from Poland, and the entire family was in Poland. We were the only one in France, and there were six children, and they were deported. Nobody came back from the three children. There are three of us that are survivors, my brother in Paris, my sister in San Francisco, and I. And we never met anybody else because everybody was living in Poland. However, after the war, we did, some family looked for us. Some on my mother's side, like an aunt from my mother's side, they knew there were some children in France, and they looked for us, and they found us. And also from my father's side, only one sister. She lived in Paris, and actually, she's the one that helped us survive. And that's about it. We were small, and remember very little from before, just running, and then being caught by the Germans.
How old were you when you were caught by the Germans?
I was 11. I was 8 when the war started, and then after our parents were taken, there were just the three of us left. And my aunt, with the help of some Jewish organization in Paris, helped us, and we were hidden in Brittany by some Gentile people who were not good to us. But my aunt helped us survive. She brought us back to Paris, and we stayed there during the entire war.
You were hidden in Paris?
Yes, just in her apartment. It's a coincidence. We were not living anywhere special, but the people just didn't denounce us. I mean, nobody knew us, but they knew my aunt. And she wore the yellow star for many years. They knew she was Jewish, but nobody bothered her. And one day she just took it off because there were so few people in the street in Paris with yellow stars. And we just stayed home. And there were maybe four, five, six children in a one-bedroom commercial unit where she was working, and we slept on the table, underneath the table. We were all around until the orphanage picked us up after the liberation of Paris. So then they gave us a good education. They helped us go back to school. That was a Rothschild family, which was very, very good to us. And we kept in contact for many years. That's about it.
And we met Hanukkah.
Yeah.
In Israel, I think it's your aunt's cousin sent you from England to Israel to meet your family.
Yes.
That's where we met.
And your children are here now, right?
Our children are here.
Right. I would love for you to introduce them to us as well.
Okay, we shall do that.
Thank you for sharing your stories with us.
At this time, I want to introduce my family. You heard my wife just a few seconds ago.
And I'm Stephen. I'm the oldest son. I'm married to Tanya, and we have three kids.
And I'm Carmela, and I'm married to Harry Barenbaum, and we have two kids, a boy and a girl.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for all being here, your father's testimony.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is on the left. On the left side, you have my grandfather. This picture was taken in Germany around 1934. And next to him, his name is Meyer Vulkan. And next to him is his wife, Simcha Vulkan. She had 9 children, and you have the oldest son, Nathan, his younger brother, Jacob, and his little sister, Anna. On the left is my mother, Adela. On the right is my father, Hermann. And this picture was taken about 1922-ish. And they were just going to the theater. This picture was taken 1935. This was the wedding of my uncle, my mother's brother, Jacob, who got married to Friedel. And we were all at the wedding. This is me. This is my brother, Willy. And my mother and my sister and my father and my two cousins on the bottom there in Israel. The rest, most of them, were killed by the Germans. This picture was taken the end of April. I was sent by the Germans to Lourdes, where I gained 23 kilo, approximately 50 pounds. And this was the uniform we were wearing in the concentration camps. Of course, this is myself, Sigi Hart.
You were sent by the Germans or
the
French?
This picture was taken in May of 1945, shortly after I met my mother back in Toulouse. And this was taken for a souvenir. This picture was taken in 1949 while I was in the army, also with a good friend of mine who is now in New York, for a souvenir. This is me and Joseph Bernstein. This picture was taken in 1946, beginning. On the left side, you can see this is me, Ziggy. In the middle is our friend Louis Goldman. And on the right is my brother Wolf, Willy. Ludi Goldman wrote a book about our escaping from France to Italy. This picture was taken as a souvenir. This picture was taken in 1946 in Palestine, now Israel. On the left is Willy, my brother. In the middle is my mother, Adela. And I'm on the right-hand side. The picture was taken also as a souvenir. This is March 1st in New York, 1957. We arrived in New York, and my wife's sister, who is on the left, Michelle, and my wife Vera in the middle. And believe it or not, this is our Captain Hart when he was a year old, when we came from Israel. This picture was taken November 5th, 1993, in Florence, Italy. It was a memorial on the day where the people were deported from Florence to Auschwitz. In the background, if you can see, there's a whole list of the people who went with me. And I was the only one back on this transport. Taken in 1993 as a souvenir for me. My brother, my son. This is January 19, 1985, my daughter's wedding, Carmela. And from the left, you have Stephen, then Vera, and then Harry, the chatan, and Carmela, the bride, and me on the side. And this was a wedding picture. We have to get it together. This picture was taken about in June of 94. On the left is Nicole Birnbaum, and on the right, her brother Jeremy Birnbaum. These are the children from my daughter, Carmela and Harry Birnbaum.
These are grandchildren.
Our grandchildren. June 5th, our son's wedding. On the left, it's me, Sigi, and then my wife, Vera, and then Tanya, his wife now, and Steve. This was their wedding on June 5th, 1989. On this picture is was taken in August of 1994, and you have Brendan and the little baby Jason and Kevin. These are our son's children and our grandchildren, of course. And this picture was taken for grandpa and grandma.
And Sigi, when you look at these pictures of your children and your grandchildren, and you think to their future and your great grandchildren even, what kind of message would you want to tell them about your life and your experiences? If you could tell them something, what would it be?
I would tell them to be strong, to be good Jews, never to deny that they're Jews, and to be good people, strong people, not to let things push them down.
And when you think back about the experiences of your life that you've shared with us, is there something about that that you would want to tell them about the way that you've lived?
I hope that they never, ever will have anything near to go through what we went through during World War II. That they should never know about this kind of problems. To be good people.
Thank That's you very all. Much for sharing your testimony.
Thank you.
Sigi Hart, April 19, 1996, Auschwitz, Poland. My name is Piotr Kadlczyk, K-A-D-L-C-I-K. I'm conducting an interview with Sigi Hart, Auschwitz, April 19, 1996. So please spell your name now.
My name is Sigi Hart, S-I-G-I, capital H-A-R-T.
So please, can you tell us about the first moment that you arrived here?
I was caught in Italy in 1943 in Florence, and we were put together for transport to be deported from Italy. November 6th, we were put in a train, boxcar, women, men, and children, and we were transported to the train station where we saw a very long train with boxcars, and on every corner of the wagon was a sign reading Auschwitz. Of course, we didn't know what Auschwitz means. I have never heard about it. And people were wondering, they were guessing, is it Germany, is it Poland, are they taking us to work? The Germans told us right away, we take you to work, and men and women and children will stay together, and don't worry, just board the train and you will be fed. They didn't tell us how long we will be on the road, they just gave us a little bread about this size. And we start boarding the train, and when the wagon was full, we thought this is enough people. No, the SS said, no, we have to get moved together to get more people in the boxcart. They squeezed in about 60, 70 people in a small boxcart. We had hardly a room, I'm not talking about sitting, but to stand up there. They closed the doors from the boxcar and the train started rolling. I was alone. My father escaped, my brother escaped, and I kind of joined an Italian family who had a boy and a daughter and was husband and wife. And I stuck to them because I was all by myself. Like I said, the train started rolling and we could look through a little window where there's barbed wire. We wanted to see what direction we're going, but it was not much we could see there. Everybody wanted to go there. And we were stopped. We were on the way about 8 days. And we were stopped, twice they stopped to empty the buckets. We couldn't empty ourselves. We had to do it in a bucket they left in the train. And once they put us food in the wagon, and then we continued. Of course, we did not drive straight to the camp. Because from Italy to Poland, the maximum of 12 hours in a boxcar shouldn't take 8 days. But there were much more important trains. We saw trains rolling by with British prisoners and German soldiers going to the front while we were staying sidetracked. Sometimes we were standing there for a whole day. And we arrived in a place that's called Birkenau. Birkenau, they opened the doors, and as soon as the door opened, we saw a lot of people, inmates with stripes, clothes like pyjamas, and they came to us, raus, raus, schnell, and they pulled us out from the wagon. We wanted to take our luggage. He said, nein, later, you know, you're going to get your luggage. So the women and men, everybody jumped down, and the place was here, exactly where I'm standing. We were disembarked here in this place, and there was a few SS officers with dogs, and the inmates pushed the men separate, and the woman with the children separate. And there was everybody wanted their luggage. They didn't know will they need something to take out from the suitcases or not, but they were not allowed. We were put on the side, and a few SS officers came and started to push the people on the side. The women and children went to this side, and the men on that side. They made us stay in one line, and the officer went by like this, and as soon as the SS officer pointed a finger, the inmate pushed the men toward the women, until we were about 14 people left from this transport.
How many people were on this transport?
There were approximately 1,200. And from the 1,200, I know they took 14 people. At this time, I don't know why we were separated. I tried to infiltrate myself, to go to the women, because I rode all the time with this family and with the girl. So I tried to get her. And one prisoner, he grabbed me. He says, stay here. Don't move. So I didn't move. I didn't know that this was my lifesaver, because if I would have been if it would be possible for me to go to the other side, I wouldn't be speaking to you now. Anyway, we 14 people were put aside, and the women and children, there came trucks here. They were loaded on the trucks, and an SS officer came to double check on us. He made us stay in one line again. He saw the 14 men. He said to us, is there somebody who doesn't feel good from the trip? He is tired or something. Please let me know. We have a special treatment for those people, and you have nothing to worry about. So my best friend's father, who was at the same wagon, because My father escaped from Italy with my friend, and I got stuck with my friend's father to be deported. So my friend's father had a hernia surgery, and he says, "Oh, Herr Officer, I had a small surgery. As soon as the SS heard surgery, he said, oh, you go with the women and children, you get your special treatment." And he was loaded with them to the trucks, and they left. And they took us in to a barrack where they told us to undress completely. We undressed, and we were walked to a second barrack. Our clothes was left there. We walked naked. It was November. We walked to the second barrack, and we had to wait outside and to call everybody in. Everybody was shaved, all the hair, underarms, on the head, and you know, and our private parts was taken off. And when I came in, there was two or three prisoners, and they said, where are you coming from? And we told them, and they were talking in Yiddish. I knew a little Yiddish, so I told them, and we asked them where the rest of us, where the men and the children. So there was a window, and he pointed in this direction where the woods are. There was two big chimneys. They were smoking and flames shooting out from the chimney. He says, here you see, this is where they're coming out. And I didn't understand what he means. So I says, what do you mean they're coming out? I don't see any people. So he started kind of laughing. He says, the people come out of the chimney, they're all burned. Of course, we were horrified, started crying. And they pushed us to the next barrack to take a shower. We showered, and on the end of the barrack was a man who gave us clothes, a pair of pants, a jacket, and a very shirt, one shirt with underpants. And we had to dress it. Some had too short, some were too long. They didn't give us by measured suits, you know. Whatever was available, they gave us, they threw to us the striped clothes, and we looked at each other, you know. A small moment ago, we were with hair, we were dressed in our winter coat with shoes and pants, and here we look like monkeys with the stripes, shivering from the cold. And the men, of course, who had women and children, they cried all the time, you know. They didn't know what to do. We were pulled out from the barracks and came to a place where there were a few inmates sitting there. They grabbed our hand and they tattooed the number on our hand.
How were you doing this?
They had like a pen and with a needle, and they went very fast. They went like this, putting in the number, and shoved us off, you know, next, and until we all 13 had the numbers. And we waited, because probably the commandos didn't walk in. We had to wait till everybody walks in. And then we were walked in this way here, where the quarantine camp was. The quarantine camps, I don't know why they kept the prisoners separate for 4 weeks. They shouldn't be sick or give any sickness to other people. Here they were burning women and children and men. And here, the opposite, they try to keep the inmates healthy from people who maybe have any sickness. So finally we arrived in a block. A block is a barrack. And of course all inmates. And they started calling in Polish. What I found out a little while later, they called out the numbers to distribute the food. And most of the inmates here were Polish people who talk Polish to their inmates. And when they called my number, I didn't understand it. So I didn't go forward to collect my food. So I was waiting and waiting. And when everybody got their food, and I see I was standing there, so I asked, so I went forward to the block elder, who is the responsible person for this barrack. I said, "Where's my food?" So he started shouting to me and gave me a kick in the butt. And I ran because I don't want to get another one. So I started to ask somebody if he understand German or French, that's the language I was speaking, to teach me my number in Polish so that I don't lose any more food, because this food was very important to survive.
What kind of food it was?
Food. In the evening they gave you three-quarter like water, and there was some beets swimming around. But when you didn't eat for 8 days, right, you know, then anything what you can get is food. So it was actually a soup. So I learned my number overnight, so to say, because the next morning when they called for the ration to get food, I knew my number in Polish already.
Do you remember it until now?
Yes. You want me to repeat it in
yes.
Polish? Sosjeżdżą Siedemset, siedemdziesiąt cztery. Right? I will never forget this number, because this was my name. We did not have any more names there. We got also a big number on our jackets with a triangle, a red triangle, going, pointing down. The red triangle was a political. And then they gave us another triangle painted in yellow, going up, what makes together the Star of David, and they put in the country from where we were deported. Though I'm born in Germany, but I got the I for Italy. So there were a few people there who called me, "Oh, you Italian," instead of my number. They called me Zvucho, what means Italian. So I explained, I'm not Italian, I was born in Germany. Okay, this was the quarantine. The next morning we had all to get up.
What time?
Well, it was around 6 o'clock. In the winter, the mornings are still dark. So they didn't want the prisoners to go out in the darkness. But they kept us out later in the evening to make up for it. So we had to run and wash ourselves. There was a little round barrack with a few faucets on it. And everybody had to wash. And we came back for the appel. We're standing at the appel, sometimes an hour and a half, it didn't matter. They were, appel means a roll call, you know, when they count how many people you have, the block elders had to come and say he had so many people, let's say 850 or 900 people, and when they made a roll call, everything has to come out to the exact number. And if there was a number missing, we had to stay there until he was found. So they counted us, then we had to run back in the barracks, and we got a little piece of bread, not bigger than maybe 2 inches by 4, and a cup. We didn't have a cup a day. We used our soup. We got a soup bowl. This was our utilities for using for food and whatever we get. So we got a cup of black water. I don't know if it was tea or dishwater or something, but it was warm and we drank it. Some people tried to organize there. We didn't know. We grabbed the bread and we ate it right away, and we drank this little black juice, and this was it. But we didn't know at that time that the next food will be in the evening, this 3/4 of soup. So in this quarantine camp, we did not go out to work for obvious reasons. They put us in quarantine, we should mix with others. But they couldn't let us sit there doing nothing. So they formed commandos and they got separated, they got out with us to the railway station. There were box carts with cement and iron pipes, what has to be unloaded, and telephone post, like you see here, the big telephone post. A cement sack was about 50 kilo, it's 100 pounds. And you had to take it from the box cart, and it was a board, and you had to run down about 20 feet. As all done in running, you have to put down, you could not throw the sack down, because if this open, the sack breaks the paper, it's sabotage. And this was light sabotage, you get 25 on your behind. So you get your cement sack and you're running down this board, you're running over to the ramp, you put your sack straight, and then you run back for the next one. And if somebody was not running fast enough or he was walking, the capo was behind him with a rubber pipe and was hitting him until he starts running. So in the evening when we came back into the camp, we had roll call, and they counted again the prisoners. And like I said, sometimes we were an hour, sometimes 2 hours outside there. And it was so cold, it was November, we came from Italy. There's also winter, but not like here in Poland. We were standing back to back, the prisoners to warm up, you know, and the more people we got together, we had more warmth. But then when the blockade came and he saw us all crowded together, he came and with a whip and got us apart, start counting again. And if everything was okay, he counted everybody, then he counted again. And again, until we really got very tired, took us into the block, and they distributed the food again. This time I got my soup because I knew my number of Polish. So we were in this camp about, by the way, the next day I arrived in Auschwitz was my birthday.
How old you were then?
I just turned 18. I turned 18, and we went out the next day, and there was a train with frozen, with bricks to unload. And from the transport, the wagon was a box car, but open. It must have fallen snow on them, it was white, and they froze together. Now, when you went to this car and you could grab a bunch of bricks, two or three, you're lucky. You could not break off bricks from it. If you're unlucky, you get eight or seven bricks, you know, you could hardly walk with them, and you could not break them to make a lighter, you know, to take less. And I was looking for one brick or two brick, and the capo was looking at me, and I was new. I said, well, I don't know all the rules yet. So I took one here and one there, and the capo came, and he gave me with his fist in my face, and he showed me what I should take, and I was bleeding all over, and this was my initiation into the quarantine lager. And this went on for 1 month. We were in the quarantine lager.
How many people were in this quarantine lager, roughly?
We were about 900 people in one barrack. And there was at least, I would say, 20 barracks.
And what countries they were from?
From all the countries. They were from France, from Greece, from Italy. We were from Italy. And Dutch people, and of course Poles, and that's it.
And how you were guarded in the quarantine lager?
How we were guarded? We were guarded by, you can see the guard posts here. They were standing with a machine gun.
Mm-hmm.
Each guard had a machine gun, and two guards with dogs were walking between the electric wires. Wherever there was a double line, they were working with the dogs to check.
Do you remember if during this quarantine people were trying to kill themselves? How the people were feeling about being in such a place?
Well, it was not a picnic. We were laying in bunks, in wooden bunks, 9 in a row, when tree high. And when you were laying, first of all, you go in a bunk, you lay down with people you don't know, and you come from the outside world. Maybe the other ones came from other camps or from ghettos. We came really from a country. We were not in a camp there. It was very weird to be laying down. You could not move. You can only turn around when the end decided to turn. Everybody had to turn over too. You couldn't lay in the width because there wasn't enough room. And then they gave you, for 9 people, 3 or 4 blankets. And if you were in the middle, you always knew that you get a piece of blanket, that you will be warm. But when you were on the 2 outsides, you know you will be at night without a blanket. And then you were laying with your knees to your belly, and you were shivering because they didn't heat the barracks then. So of course the new ones, who they called the Zugang, we were always on the end. And sometimes from the weight of the people, if the one board breaks, all 9 fell on the 9 below, and the 9 below, so it was a whole mess, and you couldn't make much noise, because if the block artist was listening and here there's something going on, he came out and we get all beaten.
And who was the block artist, do you remember?
My block artist happened to be a French guy, a Jewish guy, who was the block artist. He probably was in a different camp before, and he must have been an organizer, so he was chosen as block artist. He was the one who got the soup in the evening, and he is the one who got all the portion of breads. They were cut, they knew from one bread, a square bread, you can make 4 portions. Now they were checked out from the Oberkapo too, that the portion should be okay. So what they did do, we found out later, they cut the bread in the middle, they cut a big trench away, pushed the bread together, and then they made 4 pieces out of it. So the block editor, of course, had always extra bread, and he was giving it to his friends. If they were French people from his country, so he gave them the bread. And you could not exist in this camp without any help, because the food was figured out for 100 to 120 calories. And in the quarantine camp, you were not working hard, and you came from the outside, so you were still fed, not as miserable as the other people who were called Muslims, you know, who were longer in the camps, and they were so skinny. And if you don't organize some food, you couldn't make it. This was after four weeks, we graduated to the working camp.
Number 2, Sigi Hart, April 19, 1996, Birkenau. So after you left quarantine camp, what happened next?
After I left, I didn't leave. They transported us over to the day lager. Walking over. We walked over to the day lager, who was here someplace, the working camp, and we were put again into barracks, and were chosen for a certain commando. This means you were put in a certain group. you know you belong to this group and you walk out with them every morning and you come back every evening with them, and you have to be ready in the morning to walk out. So the rules were the same. You got your time in the morning to wash in a hurry and to get your soup, and you started to group together in commandos. It depends how many people were in a commando. If you were in a small commando, it was easier. In a bigger commando, you have to wait till everybody's ready, because the Germans wanted you to march out from the camp in a row of five so that they can count better, because when you walk through the gate, they don't want to have any commando to be stopped, so because it holds back all the rest of the commandos. So the capo made sure that when we started walking, and we walked like soldiers, of course, we had to go all left, right, left, right. And when we came to the gate, the capo was shouting, "Mützen up!" You grabbed your rag from the head and you marched through like a soldier, you know, with your making the noise. It was a loud noise because everyone was wearing those wooden shoes. So we walked out with the commando, and we walked the pens. Some commandos were 40 minutes away, some commandos were 20 minutes away, and you had to walk and stay in line like a company of soldiers. Once you get to the working place, you started working. There was one German, he was a foreman. He distributed the work, what has to be done. When it was construction, we were put in to pull the wagons with pipes on it and with material for building. Three men had to carry a telephone post of, how tall is a telephone post? 15 meters? About 10 meters? 10 meters, 8 meters, yeah, well, I'm converting from feet. So we were three men to carry a post or to push the wagons, shovel dirt, make the holes for the telephone post, and work. It was really, really hard work, and there was no rest you can take. Of course, the capo sometimes went in, they had a little shack when he went in with the German foreman. They were more on a friendlier relationship. And we were working out. When we saw this, we tried to really to take a break. But we are always watching the door. In case we see the door moving, we all were working hard again. So this was our work here in this day lager. It went on every day, and we had selections. We had a selection once in 10 days, once in 2 weeks. They called out the Blocksperre. All the Jews knew already it is selection when they called Blocksperre. All the Jews had to stay in the barracks while the Gentile people were going to their commandos to go out to work. After we got this little piece of bread and the juice, what they called coffee, we undressed. We had to be undressed until this German commission came in. If they came at noontime, so you were for 5 hours naked, standing there and waiting for them. And if you were lucky, they came after an hour, so you could get dressed again. So they walked in the barracks. They came mostly 5-6 SS, and the camp Schreiber, the Schreiber was the guy who had a big block with a pencil and paper, and he was writing down the numbers. We had to file in one line, and we were naked. We marched toward the officer, to the SS officer, had to pull out our tongue, had to turn around to the rear and then turn back, and then the SS made like this or like this. So you knew when he made like this, you had another chance of life, and when he made this, you knew you were condemned to death, because in the same evening they came and they loaded you on the truck and you were brought to the gas chambers.
And what were the reactions of the people when they realized that they're chosen to death? How did people react to that?
They were crying, they were screaming, because they knew their fate was sealed. There was no help, there was no getting off the list, because the Blocksperre means you cannot leave the barrack for this day until the group of workers came back in.
Okay, so we're talking about the selection. So what were the people's reactions when they realized that they're actually chosen to death?
People started crying. And we were together with Polish prisoners, of course, not Jewish, Gentile people, who could get packages from home. After 2 months in the camps, I learned enough to understand Polish to be like a translator, because the German did not allow the Polish people to write in Polish home, send me a package. They had to write it in German. By then they knew I'm not Italian, I'm a German. They came to me and asked if I can help them to write a letter home in German, and they will compensate me for that. They will give me some food, because it was impossible to work and to live on the food you got, the ration what you got here. And in the evenings, when people were going to rest, people come to the bank with a piece of paper, with a special card from the Germans, what you had to use. And I wrote them, they were explaining to me, write them this and this, I'm healthy and I feel good. They had to write this. And please send me a package so that it helps me with my food ration. And for this I got an extra onion, or I got a little piece of bread, or I got a little piece of salami. And those people now to come back who were selected for the gas chamber, they were raiding the Polish beds. They said, we're going to die tonight, at least let us die with a full stomach. So they raided the packages, because you cannot take the package to work. So they were under the bed pillow. And the people who were in the same barrack, they knew where the package were laying. They wouldn't dare doing it if they wouldn't be condemned. Because when the Polish people came back and they saw their package were empty, they beat the hell out of us. Doesn't matter if you were condemned or not, because we ate with the ones who were condemned. There were extra food, we ate it. So this is one little episode. And I took extra job on the weekend. This means weekend. On Sunday, we did not walk. We did not go out to work. But we had Lauser Controller, what takes a couple hours, at least 3 hours, for an inspection that you have no lice. Then the hair had to be cut every 2 weeks, because when it became a certain length, and you don't cut it, you are under suspicion of escaping, because with a shaved head you cannot escape. And by doing this, I got some extra soup from the Blockältester, and I also did sometimes night watch. Night watch was, we did not have a toilet in the barracks. We had a big barrel, and everybody came and made into the barrel. And the night watch had to watch out that when the barrel comes 3/4 full, to stop the person who comes the last to make in the barrel, the two last one, to keep him, to take out the barrel to the toilet. And this was a big job, because in the winter time, you cannot get dressed, because it's night. So you had to go with your underwear and with the two sticks, carrying the barrel to the toilet, and you had to turn it over. And sometimes you get wet from all the pee there. So, and you had to wash with ice water. So everybody who was close to the girl from the bunk could see it's 3/4. They would rather hold on, even pee in bed, not to go out at night to do the service. And this brought me in some extra food too, and the washing some socks or pants from the kapos. They had the boots, shiny boots. We shined the boots and did all kind of extra work to survive.
And who are the kapos? What kind of people they were? Were from?
Kapos were from all kind of people. They had Polish, French, they were Jewish, and they were non-Jewish. They were good kapos and they were very bad kapos. I mean, it depends. We were under their control. If you had a good capo, so he was beating you less. If you had a bad capo, you can march home sometimes from work and carry a dead person, and because there was no question asked if somebody was beaten to death. And to make it a little harder on us, after work, if they were constructing, continuing to construct in the camp, the whole commando had to bring in 2 bricks under their arm. Not enough, you were after 12 or 14 hours outside working, you had to take 2 bricks under your arm and you had to march in with them, and then you had to put them in a certain place where the building is being done. And you can imagine, if 30,000 people walk out and everybody brings 4 blocks in, you don't need trucks, transportation to bring in those bricks. So that's what we did.
Are there any people attempting to escape from your commando?
The only thing I know from an escape was one morning we heard that 3 prisoners escaped. And they caught 2, and these 2 were shot on the outside. They were brought into the camp. They were sat on a chair at the gate where we were marching out for work. They were sitting on a chair held by a stick in the back, and they made sure that we could see the bullet holes, and showing us this happens when you try to escape.
In your commando, you had the case of people killing themselves because of the situation they were.
I myself have not witnessed, but I've heard about that people. I always was optimistic. I always said to myself, by the way, my mother was born in Auschwitz, and I always said to myself, Sigi, you're not going to die where your mother is born. You will get out of here. Though that we saw the chimney smoking and the fire coming out from the chimney, I always had hope. I never gave up. And this was very, very important in my case.
Did you keep up the moral. Mm-hmm. Did you ever get sick? Sick enough to seek for medical assistance here at the camp?
Yes. Matter of fact, I got sick at the time. It was just at the time when we were supposed to march out from the camp when the Russian came. I had a tonsillitis and fever, and the rumor was that they're going to evacuate the camp, and whoever is not able to walk will be shot in the camp, because the crematorium in January of 1945 ceased to exist. They did not burn people. And the end of the. To come back to this camp, one day in April of 1944, they were forming transports. And whenever you hear transport, you were scared because you didn't know, is it to go to the gas or is it a legitimate transport? So everybody was called out by the numbers, of course, and we were about 2,000 each, 2,000 on one side, 2,000 on the other side. And the message, what was rumoring around, was these 2 transports are going to Warsaw to clean up the Warsaw ghetto after the uprising. And in the last minute, they canceled our transport where I was in and sent us over to Monowitz camp, Auschwitz III, what was called Buna, working for IG Farben. Okay, we are walking here through Auschwitz, what is Birkenau actually. Birkenau was constructed by the inmates from Auschwitz. And as you can see here, this was all barracks. And the D-Lager was approximately over there. The quarantine lager was over there. And there's a gypsy. This was a woman. The women were on this side of the camp. And a little more right to this side was the gypsy camp. And you can see where the trees are, approximately there and there. There were two, I remember four crematoriums, and they were smoking and shooting fire out from the chimney day and night. It was ongoing day and night, especially when the Hungarian transports arrived. Everything had to be done running. If you were walking in the camp on your day when you were doing chores in camp and an SS man walked by, you had to walk by like a soldier and take off your hat. I witnessed once where one inmate, he thought the SS man didn't see him. He let the inmate pass and then he turned around and called him toward him, and he almost beat him to death because he did not take his hat off. And he said, next time you will be shot. And the ramp you saw in this camp was going up to the end of the where your eye can see. It looks much different. It looks like just like a ghost town. And that's it. As you can see here, there's a few barracks left. And when you see in front of you, there's just chimneys. These places were hustling and bustling with people, with thousands of people. And now all what's left, it's looking like a cemetery. Just crying to the heaven to remember, not to forget Birkenau and Auschwitz and all the other camps. That's all what's left. I was told there was a very cold winter here a few years ago, and people came and took apart the barracks for firewood. This is what it was worse for, just for firewood.
Can you please tell us what is this place?
Where are we now?
We are standing here on the grounds of Buna Monowitz. We were working for IG Farben, and as you can see behind me, the big chimney was built by prisoners, and unfortunately you cannot see much what's left because the Russian occupation here after the war took everything what was not cemented in the ground, they took with them. And what you see there is what's left over. We worked out from this camp every morning, marched to the factory, to IG Farben, and worked there for the whole day. And at night we came back to the camps. And here people had opportunities to escape, because I think we were about close to 100,000 people working here, including French laborers, forced labor, British World War prisoners, and then of course the concentration camp inmates. We could not have any contact with them. If you were caught talking to one, you could get 24 on your behind and be in a bunker for a month. So there was no communication for the regular inmates of the camp. There may have been, like Freddy before mentioned, some people who had contact and who were involved in the underground in the camp, who were transmitting messages in and out from the camp this way. This place was known probably by the Allied, because a few times, I cannot see too much, but a few times they sent airplanes here to bombard the place. And as soon as the Germans knew that they're coming, they had in all directions big, big barrels here, what they released a kind of smoke to cover up the factory and the camp. And we couldn't go, when they were bombarding, we couldn't go to shelter, so they built for themselves over there in the corner, they built shelters where they went, when the bombs was falling, they went to those shelters over there and were hidden while the bombs were falling. We didn't have shelters. So this was our working place here for me. It was almost for a year, and January 18, 1945, when the Russian approached, we could hear already the heavy artillery. The Germans took Auschwitz 1, 2, and 3 and other camps. It was over 100,000 people walking in the infamous March of Death. We were walking from here to Gleiwitz. In Gleiwitz, there were already street fighting, and they had time to put us on the flat wagons, open, not closed. It was snowing. They transported us to another camp. And from Gleiwitz, we went to Nordhausen. Nordhausen was also a big factory for the V-1 and V-2 rockets, where we were working 3 months. And when the Americans came, they sent us over to Bergen Belsen. And in Bergen Belsen, we were liberated after 2 weeks.
And tell me, how was life here in Buna? Was it easier to be when you were in Birkenau in quarantine camp, or it was better here?
Well, in a way, we didn't see the crematorium, the oven smoking and shooting fire out from the chimney. In this concern, we were better off here. We knew that if we work and we are strong enough, we could live another day. Though they came also every 2 weeks here with selections, and the last selection I went through, they took about 90% out from the people because they had new arrivals from Hungary in the end of the 40s, and so they did not need the people who were working for a few months here and getting tired and skinny, so they had new people to come and work. But like I said before, fortunately for us, the Russian came, and we could leave this camp here. And the German though made sure to tell us that we should not think that we will be liberated, because before they go, they will have time to shoot us all.
Mm-hmm. You said that this chimney over there reminds you so many things from the time that it was. Do you know what was the purpose of this very chimney? What was it used for?
This chimney, I think, is a chimney from a power station. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. In my mind, it stayed forever, all the time. As soon as somebody mentioned Buna, this chimney came into my mind, and a train going by, a working train, not a passenger train, a train went by here and sounding the horn from the train. And certain things with people stays in. This is what stayed with me, this chimney, and this is why I wanted so much to come here and see it.
Mm-hmm. And do you remember any particular story about this place, about your life in Buna that you want to share with us?
Well, there were French transports coming in. I lived a while in France, also hidden during my story. And I spoke pretty good French. And when new people came in, I found a young boy my age who happened to be in the same barrack. And we became kind of friendly. And I remember his name was Simon. And he had some friends where he sometimes got soup. I got sometimes some soup. And we shared, so like brothers. Unfortunately, I don't know what happened to him, because after the march from here to Gliwice, we got away from each other, and I never heard from him again.
Is there anything else you would like to say as a kind of a personal message that will be kept?
A personal message? I can only say that people shouldn't become animals. They should respect other people. And when this will be happening, we will have a much nicer world to live in. And I think this is my message.
Thank you.
Name, and people won't know who Freddie is. Uh-huh. Unless it's cross-referenced to his testimony. That you want to share? Is there a particular story besides Simon? Is there, do you remember any, watching any atrocities? Do you remember any good moments, bad moments?
We all had bad moments. We were not shortcoming of bad moments. You know, it was not a picnic camp here, you know.
Right.
So
Do you remember your emotions, your feelings, your day to day? How did you feel?
I felt lousy. We were walking out in the pyjamas to work, you know, and then I mentioned it in Birkenau, you know.
Okay. Was there
what you should say is that as hard as we worked, we stayed human.
Yeah.
And all okay. We wanted is to survive with honor. Yeah. That's a good message, no?
When you started to warm up, and I realized
nobody should say to
the German wanted us to become animals, and as inhumane we were treated, we stayed human beings. We stayed human and treated people humanly.
And where you were talking about the IG Farben, what they were doing here?
IG Farben was more or less an experimental factory. They tried to make gasoline from coal, and also trying to make rubber for tires for their military trucks, for the tanks, for all the war effort.
So maybe you would like to introduce.
I was together here in this camp at a time when a good friend of mine, Freddy Diamond?
Oh, yeah.
Freddy?
Oh.
He came with me here from the United States. We came to visit this camp and to honor our friends who are not with us anymore. And unfortunately, I was a witness of Freddy's brother, who was murdered here by the Germans. He was trying to help other people, and this was his biggest crime, that he helped other people to stay human. He was hung in this camp, and the whole camp of 12 to 15,000 men had to stay, watch it, and march by to see what happened when somebody does something bad. But it had just the opposite effect on us. It gave us at least the will to live for something. He was a hero in our eyes. What do you have to say, Freddy? Do you have any comment?
I look back at Buna and I say clearly, because of the experiences that we had in Buna, we both of us became better human beings. We became more sensitive to other people, and we feel that we have an obligation not only to ourselves, also to our fellow man. That is the lesson that I have learned from the experience in the Holocaust. And obviously, we are great supporters and fanatic supporters of the State of Israel, because there's no doubt, as long as the State of Israel powerful and just, there never will be a Holocaust of Jewish people. Never, never, never. Of this we are convinced, right?
Right.
That's all I have to say.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.